something like this. The most general form would be a0 plus a1s plus a2s squared, etc. 1 plus b1s plus b2s squared, all the way up. Which you can also write as a0 times factorization of the numerator and denominator. We know we can do this if these coefficients are real, then these become either real poles and zeros or complex conjugate pairs. So we could write them in this form. And so on and so forth. And then what we did, we developed what we determined, which proved that, what a1 and b1 were in terms of the time constants. So we saw that b1 was simply the sum of all the zero value time constants. In other words, the way you determine them is that you said for every element, for instance this inductor, you said, okay, I zero value all the other elements. In other words, I open circuit all the capacitors and short circuit all the inductors, remaining inductors. And just basically, you're even removing this in essence and nulling all the input and see what resistance you see across here. And that time constant in this case would be this inductance divided by that resistance. Or in the case of a capacitance, it would be this resistance times the capacitor. So those time constants, all of them added up, basically give you B1, and this is an exact relation, right? There's no approximation here. And then we saw that also A1 was simply the sum of tau I0s scaled by HIs, the zero value, what we call the transfer constant. So these are the same zero value time constants as here. So once you calculate them, you don't need to recalculate. You can use those values. But then HIs, which are what we call the transfer constants, are what you see, basically the ratio of the Y to X when everything else, in this case, is zero value except for element I. So in this example, if you think about capacitance CI, if you want to determine HI, what you do, you look at basically a low frequency gain from the input to the output, or this transfer function in general. That's why we call it a transfer constant, because it's not a function anymore, it's like a constant. From input to the output, but all the other remaining elements are zero value, so these capacitors are open and this inductance short, except for this one, where this would be shorted. So for determining this, you short circuit this particular element, and then you determine the transfer function. And these two give you A1 and B1 exact. Now, then we said, okay, this is good, this is useful to know, but then how can we use this? One of the applications of this is using this for determining what the bandwidth limitations are. So we said, if you had a system, let's assume that you have a low-pass system. And then let's assume that, so we have a low-pass system. And then let's say we have no significant zeros. And no significant complex poles. In that case, we said, really, what you have is the transfer function essentially is something like this. The higher order terms. And we said, as you increase the frequency, the first thing that kicks in really is this guy. And therefore, we said you could approximate this as a0 1 plus b1s, whose 3 dB bandwidth frequency is simply what? So omega h, which is this cutoff frequency, the 3 dB frequency omega h here, is in this case, for this guy, it would be exactly 1 over b1. So for the general system, it's an approximation, which would be 1 over b1, which is exactly equal to 1 over sigma tau I0, some of the zero value time constant. So this is what he said, and this is an approximation that we use. Now, I claim that, I told you that this is a conservative approximation. I didn't prove it, I didn't show it. So let me show you why it's an approximation, why is it a conservative one. So let's take second order term into account. Let's see what happens if you take that. Now, if you take that one into account, and let's go to the frequency domain there, j omega domain. So in that case, what you have really is here, you have 1 plus j v1 omega plus b2 times j squared, which gives you a net minus sign. So you get b2 omega squared. So you can see that the real part is simply this. So I can rewrite this as 1 minus b2 omega squared plus j omega, j v1 omega 1. So you can see that the second order term, so the magnitude, the overall magnitude of this thing is of course this squared plus this squared, right? Or square root of that. The imaginary part plus the imaginary part squared plus the real part squared. And if you want to get the magnitude, you have to take square root. So you can see that this second term, really, what does it do? It's making the denominator smaller. Right? Because it's subtracting from the 1. So it's reducing the magnitude of the denominator. Which means that at around the frequency of interest, so let's say around the frequency of interest, omega h, this makes the transfer function a little bit larger. So the transfer function, the actual transfer function doesn't drop as fast. So the actual transfer function around here is larger because this term makes it a little bit smaller. Makes the denominator a little smaller, the whole element becomes larger. So around here, it's actually larger, so the actual omega h, so this is the approximation. Let's call it 1 over v1. So the actual omega h is actually at a higher frequency. Now, how much higher depends on the relative size of v2 and all those things, and how conservative this can get. Depends on standard. So you can imagine if your actual transfer function is something that's very under that, then it can be substantially off. Okay? So when we saw that this is a conservative approximation. So we said, okay, great. At least it gives us an idea about where we are, and we know if that we predict something with this method, then we are going to be close. So we are not going to be under what we are expecting in terms of design. So, and we saw a design example. We basically took a stage and we improved it last time by looking at the time constant and improving. So now in that case it seemed to work reasonably well. We compared it with SPICE and we saw that we were close and reasonable, right? Now let's look at some examples where things actually start to break down and see how we can fix them. So let me show you a couple of examples first. Or let me do something else. Sorry. So what I'm going to do first, before I do that, I'm going to see if we can use that approximation that we have and expand it, take it one step farther. And then we'll see how things fail with the regular zero-value time constant, we'll see how our improved approximation can work. So let's look at it. So now, so far we used only v1, right? What if we have v2? What if v2... A1. We already know what A1 is. Correct? We know what A1 is. We have determined A1. So can we use that to get a better approximation? So let's say our transfer function does have zeros. Okay. If we have zeros, we can determine where they are, right? Based on some information about them based on A1. We know A1 is simply minus 1 over the zero time constant. Sum of the zero time. Okay, so what can we do? So let's say the transfer function in general is like this. And then the way we approximated it last time was that we said if you don't have a zero, you just took the first order term in the denominator. Now, if you do have zeros, so basically if you have a transfer function that looks like that, what should you do? So we're basically trying to see, eliminate this assumption. And see what happens. So, how would our transfer function look like? Well, my transfer function in this case would look like this. The general transfer function, right? So now, if I want to approximate it as I'm increasing the frequency, as I'm just getting to the point where the high frequency terms start to matter, useful in determining the omega h, then I can keep the first order terms of the two, right? So I can write this as approximately as a naught plus a1s divided by 1 plus b1s. So if I want to keep it that way. And I can factor a naught. Of 1 plus a1 over a0 s divided by 1 plus b1 s. Okay? So, now if I wanted to estimate the bandwidth for something like this, what should I do? This is a system with 1 0 and 1 4, right? So, the basic way of approximating it is that, you know, you can use a Taylor expansion, Taylor series expansion. You can say, well, this is approximately, you can think of it as something like this. When s is, when this term is small compared to 1. So you can think about it as b1 minus a1 over a0 times s. So you get a correction term because of the zeros, right? Because the zeros are increasing the amplitude, and the poles are decreasing the amplitude, the magnitude of the transfer function. So something like that. Now what is this term? Let's look at it. So what is b1 minus a1 over a0? Well, b1 is sigma tau I0 over I. Minus, now what is a1? A1 itself is tau I0 hi. Now, a0, which is h0, is constant. It's one constant. So all of them can get divided by that constant. And if I look at this sum, I can rewrite it slightly differently. I can write it as sigma tau I naught, 1 minus hi over h naught. Is that equal? So now it's as if I have new time constants. So this is a modified time constant that takes the effect of zeros into account. So this modified time constant that takes into account is basically scaled by this ratio, by this term. Now, but if I think about it, what is the impact? Is the impact of a right half plane zero different from that of a left half plane zero? When you are dealing with a, if you're interested in only in the 3 dB frequency, the omega h, the frequency at which the amplitude drops by 3 dB. Is the amplitude response of a left half plane zero and right half plane zero, are they any different? The amplitude response of zeros are the same, whether they're left half plane or right half plane. So from an amplitude perspective, it doesn't matter whether it's a left half plane or right half plane. But here, both of they will have different behavior, because if you had the right half plane, this ratio is going to be negative. And if it's a left half plane, it would be positive. But we really want to look at the behavior of a left half plane, equivalent of a left half plane zero. So because of that, what you can say is that then I define my modified time constants, I put a bar on top of, as tau I naught 1 minus the absolute value of this. Because the right half plane and left half plane ones don't behave any differently as far as the amplitude is concerned. So I treat all of them the same way. They will behave differently in the phase response.
How do you mathematically justify this?
Okay, so mathematically this is the thing. So the zeros, what do the zeros do? The zeros push the amplitude, the magnitude up, right? So they make it happen, they make the omega h happen at a higher frequency, right? Because they increase the amplitude, so they push it up when it starts dropping. So they should lower my time constant. So that's why this is the minus sign. So I'm saying that whether it's a left half plane zero or a right half plane zero, they do exactly the same thing to the magnitude response.
But
one
can see this in the expression.
No, because the reason I can't see it through expression is that I'm ignoring higher order terms. So this is an approximation to begin with. Right?
You're coming up with an expression mathematically, and then you are correcting it through your physical.
Yeah, you could say that I'm doing that, but it's not. Again, it's an approximation, right? It's a Taylor series expansion kind of thing. So I've already dropped a whole bunch of other terms. So you could basically will see. I mean, because what the zeros do, no matter whether they're left half plane or right half plane, So what I'm doing, it's not exactly mathematical, it's semi-heuristic. But it's a modified time constant that allows you to account for the zeros. Now, if you want to account for everything exactly the same, we can do that by going to the higher order terms, and we'll do that at some point. But this is a useful thing, and I'll show you an example of this, how it works out in a realistic example.
Say that this is really the first order correction, then we should be able to see through the Taylor expansion. But through the Taylor expansion, it doesn't give us the absolute value. Why is it the case? Why is it the case?
The reason is that this is a Taylor expansion of the complex quantity, not just its magnitude. This is a complex domain thing. When you're doing this, you're doing it magnitude. So it's a non-linear transfer function from one to the other. From a complex number to its magnitude or its phase. So the approximation is applied in a complex domain, but then we are trying to use it for the real magnitude domain. So that's the difference. That's why you don't see it directly from that. You could try to do that. Basically, what you could try to do is that basically put j omegas in here, and then go and expand it and try to calculate the magnitude, and then it becomes extremely complicated. But you could try to do that. Anyway, so this is a more accurate estimate of it because the left half and right half length things are essentially zeros are behaving the same. So let me give you an example. Let me show you an example. Let's keep this. The common emitter that we did last time. You remember that we did this common emitter. So the common emitter that we did last time looked like this. I think we made this 1 kilo ohm. This was 2 kilo ohms. This was 1 milliamp, so it was a GM of 40 millisiemens. And this being the output, this is the input. And in our calculations, we took into account 3 capacitors. Right? We had the C pi, which was 100 femtofarad. We had C mu, which was 20 femtofarad. And we had a C, did we call it CL? Which was 200. So we did the time constant. Let me quickly redo it because we're going to be using them. Tau pi 0, so this time it's fast. So the resistance seen by this guy, when everything else is null, so they're all capacitors, so they're open. It's the resistance seen on this side, which is R1, the resistance seen on that side, which is R pi. So it's C pi R1 parallel R pi. So it's 100 femtofarads times 1 kilo ohm parallel 2.5 kilo ohms for 700, so it's about 70 picoseconds. There was a tau mu naught, which was C mu, the R left plus R right plus GM R left R right. So R left was R1 parallel R pi, R right was R2, and the GM R2. R1 parallel R pi. Okay? So that's that one, and then we calculated this, it was 20 femtofarads times 700 ohms plus 2 kilo ohms plus, this was 80, so 80 times 700 ohms, and I think when we put all of that together, it became like 1200 picoseconds. And then we had a tau L, which was CL times the resistance seen by it. If you ignore R0, it's simply R2. So it was 200 femtofarads times 2 kilo-ohms, which was basically 400 picoseconds. And then we did calculate the sum of the time constants and use that to approximate our omega H. It gave us something, I don't remember what it was. Do you remember the number? 95 megahertz? Yeah, that sounds about right. So this was 2.5 with what it was. Now I'm going to do something else. I'm going to add a capacitor. So it's going to add a time constant, okay? And do this regular Z. So I'm going to add a capacitor here. Let's call it C1. And I'm going to choose an arbitrary sounding value of 4.3 picofarads. Sounds arbitrary, right? And I'll tell you how I chose it. So let's cap it. So what does this do from a ZBT perspective? It's going to add a time constant, right? It's not going to change any other time constant because I haven't changed the DC part of the circuit, so it's going to be parallel. So it's just going to add a new time constant. Let's call it tau 1, 0, which is simply what? This is the resistance seen by this guy. The source is null, so this is ground. So it's basically what it sees, this side of it is ground, is R1 on this side and R5 on that side. So it's the same resistance as that. So it's C1. R1 parallel R5, which is 4.3 picofarads times 700 ohms. It's a lot, but just
3 nanoseconds.
Is that what it is? Factor of 10, it's a factor of 13 or something like that off. This is useless, right? sense. I mean, yes, of course, if you are designed it so this meant to respect, this definitely going to mean to respect, but this is too far off to be valuable. So what has happened? I violated one of the assumptions that they had when I developed the ZVT, the original ZVT, standard ZVT, right? Which assumption did I violate? I mean, that there are no dominant zeros in the transfer function. In fact, what I did, I took this and put a zero right on top of my first pole. I chose the value of this capacitor so that my zero was almost exactly on top of my first pole. So I almost eliminated my first pole, so it becomes a second pole. But let's see. Let's see what this modified ZVT gives us this time. See if the modified ZVT does any better. So the modified ZVT tells you that, okay, you have to scale these time constants by that factor. But then the good thing about it is that you don't need to go and look at every single one of them, because most of them actually don't matter. Because for instance, in the case of C pi, H pi is zero, right? H superscript pi is zero, because if you short circuit this, then there's no transfer function. The transfer constant, this transfer constant is zero. So I don't even need to modify this, so this is good. So is HL. HL is also zero, because if you short this, then nothing gets the output. So that doesn't matter, so this is good too. Doesn't need any modification. Now, this one is non-zero. We've calculated this, so this is basically meant to be short circuit this guy. So what you see, you have an Rm here and R2. So Rm being much smaller than R2 is pretty much Rm. And then you have an R1 here. So it's a voltage divided between Rm and R pi. So this is an approximation of dropping the effect of R2. Which is approximately Rm over R1. So you can see it's small. Let's do the numerical numbers, right? The numericals. So this was 25 ohms divided by 1 kilo ohm. So this is 0.25. 1440. It's a small number. And H mu itself is positive. Right? And remember, H, what is H naught? Because everyone needs to get scaled by H naught, right? What is H naught? H naught is the transfer function when all the elements are zero values, right? The low frequency gain. What is it? It was basically the voltage divider in the input, which was basically R pi divided by R pi plus R1 times Gm R2 with a minus sign. Okay, it is what it is. And we can do the number, I think, minus 57. So you can see the ratio of this guy over that guy is going to be extremely small. So it's like 0.025 divided by minus 57. So it's like what? It's 1 over 2,000, right? And that's subtracted from a 1. I mean, this one particularly is negative, so the absolute value will change the polarity of that. But it really doesn't matter, because it's 1 minus 1 over 2,000. So you don't even need to worry about that. So this is, for all intents and purposes, good. How about this guy? Well, that depends on H1. So what is H1? When I short, H1 is a transfer function when I short, when I zero infinite value in this one, when I short circuit this guy, right? What is the transfer function from here to there? Minus Gm. So I actually increased the gain. Right? So this became minus Gm R2 because I eliminated this input resistive divider. So, and this is like minus 80. So it's minus 80 divided by minus 57. So it's greater than 1. Right? So this time constant really needs to be divided and scaled by 80 divided by 57, which is a negative number. Which is like, I don't know, it's 0.3 or something. Oh, that's what it is. It's 0.4. 1.4, 0.4, minus 0.4 times that. So this is like minus 0.4 times tau 1. This is tau 1, 0 modified. So what does this tell you? It's actually a negative time constant, which is fine. The modified ones can be negative. The original ones cannot be negative. Right? So the modified one is negative, fine. So in the new sum of the time constants, not only this doesn't add, it actually subtracts. So it's like 0.12. 1.2. to nanosecond, right? And you can see what it does, this kind of almost gets rid of that. And if you calculate this new sum with this negative time constant, what you will see is that it gives you something around 362. So the modified one, 62 pi times 362 megahertz, which is much better, right? It's still conservative, but it's meaningful. And all I have to do is just modify one of my time constants. The way I know which one is I look at the one that has an H1 that has a significant effect. It's really comparable with H0. This one has an H1 that's comparable, it's comparable with H0. If it isn't, then it doesn't matter for you. So you can see it's a minor modification that can help you. Now what did happen really? Let's think about it. So before I tell you what happened, let me show you another simpler example. Let's do another example based on what we've learned. Because we want to see in general that we can determine A1. It doesn't have to be, the A1 doesn't have to be the A1 of this particular for the bandwidth calculation. It can be for any other purpose. So let me show you a simple example. Let's say you have a resistive divider. Driven by a voltage source. And let's say you have two capacitors. Well, let's first have one capacitor here. How many poles, how many zeros? This is obvious, right? How many poles? One. How many zeros? No zeros, because there's nothing that's short. If you short this, the output will be zero. So basically, I know my transfer function is simply, so B1, which is the, there's one time constant, so there's tau, well, it's called a C2. Consistent with the notes in terms of 1 and 2. Yeah. So it's basically tau 2 0, which would be what? The time constant seen by the resistance seen by this capacitor. What is the resistance seen by this capacitor? R1 parallel R2. So this is null, what do you see here? See R1 and R2 ground. So it's R1 parallel R2 C2. And so therefore your DC transfer function, H0, is simply R2 over R1 plus R2. Which basically tells you that you have so your overall transfer function is simply R2 over R1 plus R2 times 1 over 1 plus R1 parallel R2 C2S. Fine. Now what if I add a second capacitor here? So how many poles, first of all? One pole, still, right? So I didn't add any poles. Why didn't I add any poles? Because I still can define only one independent initial condition. If I set the voltage on this guy as one volt, this is one volt. So this is ground, AC perspective, right? So I still have one pole. How many zeros? One zero, right? Because there's only this guy. Short-circuit this guy, you get an uncertain transfer function. I get basically 1. So let's redo the calculation. So H0 hasn't changed. B1 now is the sum of the two time constants. So it's this time constant plus the tau 1, 0. So it's this guy plus, well, the orders are switched. But so what is the tau 1? Tau 1 is 0. It's the resistance seen by this guy when the sources are null and everything else is 0 back. What resistance does this guy see?
R1.
Same parallel combination of R1 and R2. So I can basically make this C1 plus C2. Right? So that's B1. And then what else do I need to determine? I need to determine one more thing. H1. Because H2 is 0. I know H2 is 0. H1, what is H1? It's trivial.
1.
If you short circuit this, so, what is A1? Well, A1 in this case is simply H1 tau 1 0, because H2 is 0. It's that sum, but in this case it's just one term. So, it's 1 times tau 1 0, it's basically tau 1 0, which is R1 parallel R2 times C1. So, we're done. So, I can erase. So the question is, can I put them on top of each other? Can I make them cancel each other? Because they're both left half plane, so they can cancel each other. Right? Both the phase and the magnitude. So for them to cancel each other, they have to, something has to happen, right? This term has to be equal to that term. So let's see if that can be forced. So it's R1 parallel R2. So what is R1 parallel? So now I have to do a little bit of an algebra, right? So I have to R1 R2 over R1 plus R2. C1 is R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Well, no, actually. Oh, you see what I'm, what, okay, so there's a little bit of error. The way I wrote it down, I have to be careful about this. I factored H naught. So I had to scale this by what? By H naught. Right? So if I scale it by H naught, this is basically R1, R2 divided by R1 plus R2 divided by this. So well, all it leaves is R1. Because I factored H naught out. So I have to basically force this, these two to be equal. So this cancels that. Then you can bring this here, so you get R1 C1 plus R2 C1 equal to R2 C1 plus R2 C2. So this guy cancels that, so basically you need to have R1 C1, R2 C2. So what it tells you is that if you have this relationship, then you, your 0 and O cancel each other. And this is that what's done often in, let's say, oscilloscope probes. We have the 10x one. You see that there's a 1x and 10x. What 10x is basically a 9 to 1. So it's basically sort of like a 1k, 9k thing. And then you have the right capacity. So this way you basically compensate the input capacitance of the oscilloscope with adding an explicit capacitor there. And what that does is basically just makes your input probe a lot more flat in terms of its response. So that, you can actually put pole on top of zero. Zero on top of a pole and cancel it. That's like when you were talking about pole zero cancellation. This is one way of doing pole zero cancellation. Okay, so this is basically it. What I did at the input of that common emitter. I thought of the input of the common emitter as, what does the input look like? I said, well, the input looks like a C pi in parallel with an R pi. And I have an R1. So I have to choose my C1 in such a way that this product was the same as that product. So I chose my C1 to be C pi times R pi divided by R1, which was, what was C pi? It was 100 femtofarads times 6 picofarads, and that C pi is another 0.1, so it's 1.7 picofarads. So this total capacitance is about 1.7 picofarads equivalent. So if I wanted to choose C1, it's basically 1.7 picofarads times 2.5 kilo ohms divided by 1 kilo ohm. The 2.5 times that gives you whatever, like 2.5 plus. It's probably there, that 4.3. Which I chose. So I chose it that way. That's where the 4.3 came from. So this shows you that you have to be careful about the zeros. Because if you didn't this modification, if you didn't do this modification, you got substantially off results. And with the modification, you get much closer. Where you apply the modification really depends on which one of these capacitors has a significant impact. It gives you a large H. So it gives you a large transfer constant when you short it. Or it's an inductor when you open it. Okay. Any questions on this? Guy cannot have any impact. AC current, right?
Correct,
you're right. This is zero. But so the easiest way to see it basically is just that expression, right? That's another way to say it. But you can also think about this is connected across here. Yeah. Okay, in any case, it's basically C pi R L. And then tau L, what is tau L? What is the resistance seen by this guy? So C infinity here, what do you see looking up to the source? R L. C L R L. So let's cap, I have to give you values. I think I put 1 kilo-ohm and 1 kilo-ohm. No, 100 ohms and 20 millisiemens and 50 milliseconds. So numerically, you chose this as 50 femtofarads, 10 femtofarads, 50 femtofarads, and then this was 100 ohms and GM of 20 millisiemens. So that gives me a CMU-R1 of 1 picosecond, right? And then C pi RM, so that's RM is 50 ohms times 50, so that's basically 2.5 picoseconds. And this one is also 50 times 50, so that's another 2.5 picoseconds. So that's it. Total sum of the time constants is basically 6 picoseconds, which gives me a bandwidth of, and an estimate of, I have to look into the calculations, but 26.5 gigahertz. So it gives you a pretty high bandwidth, right? 26.5 gigahertz. And it kind of makes sense because this is a stage with low gain. So the gain bandwidth product is still like less than half of the FT. And SPICE, though, predicts 45 gigahertz. It's almost a factor of 2 off. It's not as outrageous as the previous one, but that previous one was like a really forced example. Right, because I chose the numbers to make it really bad. So, but still bad, it's like a factor of 2 off. So, what's wrong here? Well, if you look at the Bode plot for this, so let's look at the Bode plot for page 161. If you look at that, does it look unusual? What do you notice about this? The magnitude and amplitude and the phase response. Well, do you see something unusual in the magnitude? In the amplitude response?
So it's like 40 dB here, and then it's 40.
Well, it's 40 dB because it could be two poles, right?
Right.
Two poles give you 40 dB per day.
Right.
But so that's why, but just like, is there something unusual there? If you look carefully, you see a little bit of a peaking. See that magnitude is going a little up than coming down. Now, it's more pronounced in the phase response. If you look at the phase response, you will see that it's a lot steeper than a typical phase response. Because a typical phase response starts from a decade below to a decade above. So it basically goes through 90 degrees in 2 decades. If you look at the slope here, it's about minus 80 degrees per decade, which is twice as much. What do those things tell you? Basically, if I were to reproduce it here, the magnitude response is a little bit of a peaking, and the phase response is pretty steep. So it happens at a much faster scale than the typical phase drop. Those are signs of having a complex pair of complex conjugate poles, right? You have an underdamped system. It means that there's a large complex part to this. And this guy is completely oblivious to it because this sum is exactly equal to this sum. But the poles coming in complex conjugate pairs, all their complex parts are going to be eliminated because their imaginary parts are complex. The imaginary parts will become canceled because you have one positive and one negative one. When you add them, they just basically cancel each other out. So what's left is real parts. So you only see the real part of the pole. So if you have two poles with very large imaginary part, all you see is the effect of it will appear from this guy's perspective like two poles down here. play it significant here. Let's see if zero is playing a major role or not. Do you think it's playing a major role or not? It probably has some effect, but it's not that big. Because worse comes to worse, this basically, if you short circuit this, the transfer function is going to be one. One. And your transfer function before that is also one. So all it does is just basically kills the start constant. So if you do modify one, you get a better result. You get a more accurate result. But still, it doesn't come quite yet there. Affecting what we're trying to learn from this analysis, and which makes C new make pass, high pass, band pass, response. Let's look at it. What's the gain at DC? The gain is zero, right? Why? Because this capacitor is open, so basically the input is detached from the input of the input signal is detached from the input of the transistor at DC. What is the gain at infinity at very high frequency? Because this is shorter, and this is shorter. So this short system of the ground signal gets through. So it's zero, low frequency at zero at infinity. So if it has gain somewhere in the middle, it's going to be a band pass response. How many poles? Are you sure? Two, right? Because if I put this voltage at 1 volt, I can make this 2 volts. I have a resistor here. It's not because of the now the resistor is in series. Right? But okay, how many zeros? 1 0, correct. Left or right half plane? It's the left half plane, right? Because it doesn't change the polarity. If you short it, it doesn't change the polarity. So I have two poles, one left half plane, zero. And I have a bandpass response. That's what the minimum I need for a bandpass response anyway, if you think about it, right? A bandpass response, something like this. Right? So I have to have some zero somewhere. I'm sorry, some pole, let's say some pole at zero frequency. And then I need to have a zero for this to happen. Correct? And then I need another pole for that to happen. So, how do you deal with this? What should we do about it? We can do time constants, right? We can do zero value time constants. But what do you think it's going to tell me? How does this transfer function look like? Let's just do an approximate. See what it's going to look like. Based on what we've learned so far, we know it has two poles and one zero. So it's going to look like this. V1s plus is squared, and then it would be a naught plus a1s. It's got only one zero, right? So what is this going to tell me? What is zero value time constant going to tell me if I just apply it blindly to this?
Maybe you cannot to pull that zero frequency because of the one.
It's going to tell me b1, right? But b1 may or may not be useful for me. For what I'm trying to do, right? What's B1 going to tell me? Yeah, but it's not even going to tell me about this, because this is determined by this is zero. Right? So it's not that useful. I can calculate B1. I can calculate two time constants and it will give me some number. But it's not useful, because really I have to separate these. I have to really think about the other notation. You remember when I said we had the transfer function, we could write it in several different ways. One of the ones, when you have a bandpass response that was more useful, is writing it in terms of poles and inverse poles, inverse zeros and inverse poles for low frequency stuff. And so something like this. And poles and zeros at high frequency. Then you have an A mid, which is the mid band gain, which is the gain here, times regular poles. Right? This is more useful because now if I can separate my system into a low frequency part of the this part of the response and that part of the response and treat them separately, that's a good thing. Because that's our general philosophy. We want to break, divide and conquer, right? We want to break it into as many individually simple parts as possible and then analyze them separately. Because we don't want to make our life unnecessarily more difficult. So, first of all, what is the A mid? Mid band gain.
That you have some poles that's zero, because I guess you got
no, which you, if you rewrite, expand it, you will see that it looks like, so you multiply by s, you say s over s minus p1, you can basically factor 1 over p1 with a minus sign, you can basically say it's s over 1 minus p, s over p, right? So it's a zero. Oops, I actually dropped it. Yeah. So it's a zero at zero, and it's a pole at the frequency of this. Right? So that's an inverse zero, inverse pole.
Is it true that the number of inverse poles and zeros in the first fraction is equal or not?
Yes, it has to be. That's correct. So the number of inverse poles and inverse zeros have to be equal if you want to get a flat response. The same way that the number of regular zeros and poles have to be equal, even if you have non-regular ones, normal ones. Because otherwise you won't get a flat response. To get a flat response, they have to get the same contribution from reduce the ones that attenuate and the ones that amplify, the poles and the zeros, right? So anyway, so it's an inverse pole and a regular pole.
So where is our inverse zero? So that we have
there is
the same number of inverse.
Your inverse zero is at zero.
Okay,
because basically your inverse zero is doing this. Your inverse zero is doing this. Okay, so now the point is that you want to create two equivalents. So the transfer function by itself is not very useful, right? So I want to create two equivalent circuits that correspond to this. But before I do that, I have to determine what my L mid is. So the first step is determining what is the mid band gain. What is the, how do I determine the mid band gain? Short circuit this one and open circuit this one, and that will tell you what the mid band gain is. But how do I know that? How do I know in general if I am presented to the circuit which ones are the ones that are getting short circuit and which ones are getting the ones that are the ones that get open circuit? How do you determine that?
Can you take that from the zero value transfer?
Right. You can basically, first of all, if you, a lot of times you can look at them and say, but by design, you know why you put this here, right? You put this here to decouple it, so if you short it, that's fine, it's going to be better. And this is a parasitic element, this is the transistor element, right? One way to test it, if the first thing you have to look at your design, or somebody else's design, so why they put it in. But if you can't do that, one way to guide you is to see how does the response look like if you actually short-circuit it. Does it get better or worse in terms of what you're trying to achieve? So opening, shorting this guy, what does it do? It really makes this look like a real amplifier, I mean, a regular amplifier. Shorting of this one kills the amplifier. So that's the, so for the mid-band gain, you short that one and you open this one, right? So mid-band gain is simply, basically this shorted, so it becomes a gain of, so A mid is simply the voltage divider here, which is R pi divided by R pi plus R1 times Gm R2 to the minus sign. But then, if I have the mid-band, maybe I can create two equivalent circuits, one for low frequency, one for high frequency, and analyze them separately. So for the low frequency one, how does it look like? At low frequencies, this guy doesn't matter, right? It's the parasitic of the transistor. So from a low frequency perspective, this is my circuit. And then I can go and analyze the zeros and poles of this thing. So in this case, I have only one capacitor, so I know where there's one pole, nothing to worry about. The high frequency equivalent circuit looks like this. This one is shorted. So now I can analyze both of them separately and determine what the frequencies are. Now, since there's only one time constant here, then that time constant is essentially the whole frequency associated with this, in this case. But in general, for this, we have to use the method of infinite value time constants, which we'll talk about later. said, well, zero value all the other elements, and calculate the time constant, right? Calculate the resistance and calculate the time. Infinite value time constant says infinite value everything else, and just calculate the time constant. Now in this case, there is no, there is nothing else, so it doesn't matter. So it would be the same. So what is the time? What is the resistance C by C one?
R pi plus R1,
right? Because it's sitting in the middle. R pi. So in that case, basically, that tells you that the time constant is 1 over C1 R pi plus R1, which determines this frequency. And then here, you get a time constant, which is shorted so that you basically see that here directly. Now, when that happens, when you have more than one capacitor, then you really have to do the infinite value time constants, which we'll derive and use later. Which basically says, calculate this time constant when this is shorted, calculate this resistance when this is shorted, and then add the reciprocals of the time constants, not the time constants themselves. So it's actually then the sum is also different. The sum you will see, it's basically sum of the time on infinite value time constants. 1 over the tops. In this case, we had the sum of the time, 1 over the sum of the time constants. So omega L is really determined by that, is approximated as that, and omega H is approximated as that. They're two different, calculated differently. You see, here you add up the time constant. Then calculate the reciprocal, inverted. And then here basically you calculate the reciprocals and then add the reciprocal. And we'll derive that later. Okay. Any other questions? And if you have multiple capacitors here, for instance, then something like that, that would also appear. So the idea here is that you remember this presentation that I showed you the first time when we were talking about high frequency response. The reason is that you want to basically separate these two parts and analyze them separately. Because if you can do that, you make your life a lot easier than trying to, because you will have to go to higher order terms here, if you were to do that, and then you have to factor them. While you're ahead of time, you know that they are separate from each other. Okay. No more questions on this? Yes.
Let's see again about that transfer function. I guess it's true that the number of inverse poles has to be equal to number of poles, and number of inverse zeros has to be equal to number of zeros. Because, for example, in that case, you have just one inverse pole and one pole, right? And no inverse zero.
Each inverse pole or is a zero and a pole, and a regular pole and a zero.
But in that definition, you have one. I mean, you have inverse poles and inverse zeros. So the number of zi's in the numerator for the first part, it's nothing to do with the number of poles in the first fraction.
Right. The way to think about it is that, you know, this is an inverse pole, right? So what this is, what is this? What is this?
Regular zero and...
It's a regular zero, so you can think about that as a regular zero, yes, correct. So you can have a regular zero at zero, and then... But basically, the bottom line is that you don't really care at what happens at zero, right? The point of an that in time constant, you can always do that. Just, it's another transfer function, right? Yes. So here, basically, just you don't even need to do inverse poles and inverse zeros. You look at this, you can immediately tell me how many poles and how many zeros you have, right? I mean, just look at this with two. I mean, you can tell. That's judgment, right? How many poles? We didn't say that the method is limited to high frequency stuff or low frequency. It's valid for any combination of capacitors and resistors. And so two poles, right? Because I can set the initial conditions for these two as independent. How many zeros? Two. Because I can simultaneously short circuit these two and get some signal out.
I mean, if I can calculate the value for zeros too, right?
Correct. It's exactly the same procedure. You can calculate zeros and poles directly like that. This is only an approximation method. You can always use the exact method for this circuit, and you can apply the exact method for this circuit. It's basically another way of saying that you can factor the high frequency and low frequency part separately in the transfer function. Because if you don't factor it, you're making your life more miserable, right? Because instead of going to second order, you have to go to fourth order to get all the information. So it's much easier to go to two second order things as opposed to one fourth order thing, and then factor it. The idea is to simplify as much as you can up front, so you don't have to